If you're not going to be at GP Sacramento this weekend, make sure you don't miss the online video coverage on ChannelFireball.com. We've got limited expert Marshall Sutcliffe, the ever-outspoken Matt Sperling, and Hall of Famer Ben Stark on hand to provide a dauntless onslaught of insight. Coverage starts in Round 4 on Saturday and goes all the way to the finals on Sunday. Tune in to ChannelFireball.com this weekend and you won't miss a minute of exciting Theros Limited action.
Hey everyone, welcome to a Theros Sealed in preparation for GP Sacramento this weekend, which hopefully will help me just as much as it helps you. Let's go ahead and sort by rarity just to take a quick look. Ooh, Shipbreaker Kraken's a nice one. This is definitely a card that pulled me into blue. Rageblood Shaman and Hammer of Perforos are not actually that insane. I mean, Hammer's better, but... and it's better in Sealed than Draft, but I'm actually not in love with Hammer of Perforos. It's a pretty big mana sink. Night Howler's decent, and so is Anthousa, but yeah, again, no huge pull besides the Shipbreaker Kraken. Temple, just more of a bonus than anything else. Looking at piles by color, let's go ahead. We can probably dismiss white. I mean, it's got a couple things going for it, but it doesn't look all that great. I mean, I don't love Last Breath. I don't love Cavalry Pegasus. Favorite Hoplite's good if you have all the enablers. Do have Observant Alseed and Winged Steed Rider. Divine Verdict. Actually, no, this might actually make a decent base. Or not base, a secondary color to a heavier color. Unfortunately, blue looks pretty thin in terms of actual number of cards here. Since even though I do like Dissolve and I like Sealock Monster, Prescient Chimera. Boom. Speaking of GP Sac, one of my friends from Sacramento. I don't think blue's got quite enough going for it. Like, look, if you combine the blue and the white, you have 16 plus maybe a couple other sideboard card or other colored cards like the random artifacts. The other hand, black, we've got a Keepsake Gorgon. This is one of the best cards in the set. Sip of Hemlock I also like quite a bit. So even though I pulled out a bunch of blue and white cards, they didn't really look like all that close to being good enough, whereas black does have the Night Howler, which is a solid card, Read the Bones, which is nice, and then some alright filler. Ferrica's Cure is also pretty sweet. Mogus's Marauder is better in an aggressive deck, clearly, but still worth considering. I like Return Phalanx if you can kick it, as it were, and then Flesh Mad Steed is pretty bad, but you can play it if you have a bunch of Grey Merchants. Unfortunately, do not here. Fellhide Minotaur instead. Alright, we've got Begarden Hellkite here in red, along with Rage of Perforos, which is fine. Whirlwind Minotaur, also fine. I'll skip the Portent of Betrayal for now, and realistically, we'll be taking the Boulder Fall back out, since that's not great. Ill-Tempered Cyclops is very good. All the monstrous cards are so good and sealed. Hammer Perforos, again, not super exciting, but definitely playable. Same with the Rageblood Shaman, especially if you end up with a random other Minotaur or two. Spearpoint Oread, these are fine. Double Arena Athlete's interesting. Do I have good enablers? I actually do. I mean, I have Coordinated Assault, and that's about it from red. But if I combine red with something like white with a bunch of Hopeful Eidolons, that's worth considering, especially since if you can put together an aggressive deck, I like doing so. Let's see what green's got to offer. It's got some random big creatures, as is normal. Ooh, double Nylea's Emissary. Fairy's Band Centaur and Nylea's Disciple are just average. They're nothing to get excited about. Now, Lee's Emissary is very good, and having two of them is nice. I like Karamitra's Acolyte. I like main decking Artisan Sorrow. Leaf Crown Dryad is quite good. Voyaging Satyr is quite good. No Nessian Asp. Nessian Asp is so good in Sealed. It's easily the best green common in Sealed, even if it's like third or so in a draft. Savage Cern is fine. Nylea's Presence makes splashing a lot more acceptable. Alright, and there's Shredding Winds, which you can main deck if you're really short, but I don't like to. There's Fade into Antiquity, which is also a fine main deck card, but I'd rather just main deck Artisan Sorrow. I think that's much better. Being an instant is the main reason. Getting to kill their Bestow enchantment in the middle of combat is a pretty huge swing. So let's see, what do we got? We've got green at probably the most volume of cards, and a fairly solid amount of them. Like the card quality is also pretty decent with double Emissary, and Anthousa is actually pretty good. I mean, 5 mana 4/5 is fine, and then the fact that you can target her and attack for 6 is very relevant. Leaf Crown Dryad is also pretty good. So, and as normal, green is a little bit on the high end, though it does have the Voyaging Satyr and the Leaf Crown Dryad as 2 drops. To go with the green, I'm going to take out the blue for the moment. I don't think the blue is that close. I don't like the white either, since white is looking at a really low curve deck. So I think it's either black or red here. Let's start with red first. And actually, looking at red, the main advantage of red is it's got Lightning Strike, Rage is okay, Hammer is actually decent with a bunch of 5 drops, and double Arena Athlete with double Nihilus Emissary is kind of cool, but I don't really like, and this is the problem people a lot of people have with Sealeds, is they'll try and build the aggro deck, but you don't really have the tools. Like, yeah, I've got two Arena Athletes and a Leafcrown Dryad and a Voyaging Satyr, and these are all my 2 drops. You can't really build an aggro deck with 4 2 drops, and if you try to, you're just going to end up doing stuff like drawing Spearpoint Oreads, or worse yet, like Arena Athletes like on turn 7 or 8, and that's not very effective. Whereas my green gives me a good late game, and my black also has a fairly solid late game, so let's look at what green black might do. Actually, like, it bugs me if I don't have the one slot, even if I'm not playing any 1 drops. Let's see. We've got Keepsake Gorgon as a very good 5 drop. We've got Sip of Hemlock. Let's move down the spells real quick. And with Nylea's presence and Temple of Abandon, it's not, you know, unthinkable to splash something like Lightning Strike if I so chose. Let's see. Ferrica's Cure definitely getting in there. I like Night Howler. Not really a 3 drop, but I'll pretend it is. Read the Bone's also pretty good. So I like the way this is looking, even without filling up all the slots so far, because we easily can fill them up. I mean, Blood Toll Harpy is good to bestow onto. I don't really like Mogus's Marauder in this deck. That's not really what I'm doing. And I don't really have anything to give fear. I mean, I guess giving Vulpine Goliath fear is pretty nice, but past that, I'm not super in love with it. Return Phalanx is actually not the worst, especially if you've got like one way to kick it off Nylea's Presence just for value. Because, I mean, it you play it on turn 2 and it blocks reasonably well. Also, with Opaline Unicorn and Burnish Chart, which are in the deck right now, I could see something like splashing, well, at the very least, Lightning Strike. Potentially, I mean, I would want to splash Shipbreaker Kraken, but I think that's a little out of control. Even with 3 free Frixers plus a Traveler's Amulet, that feels like kind of asking for trouble. Whereas splashing something like Lightning Strike and Rage of Purphoros doesn't seem like it's too far out of the question. I mean, clearly Lightning Strike's the better of the two, but the fact that I can play one Mountain, a Temple of Abandon, and I'll have like 5 sources does make it pretty free to splash these. You can also get Destructive Revelry in, because that's actually a pretty nice one. You know, the average deck's going to have a couple targets. Let's see, is there any other... I mean, I like Bogarden Hellkite, but I probably shouldn't splash that. I don't want to play the second artifact removal spell, the Fade, and I don't really like main deck and Shred. What does this deck have going for it? It's got Sip of Hemlock, Keepsake Gorgon as decent removal, as like big creature removal. You also have to have ways to kill like, you know, 9/9s or Shipbreaker Krakens. It's got Rage of Purphoros, Lightning Strike, Ferrica's Cure as kind of like smaller creature removal. It's got Savage Surge to combo with Anthousa, and it's like a decent combat trick. Use it as a Seething Song with Karamitra's Acolyte. It's also got a decent amount of threats. I mean, I like Vulpine Goliath, Keepsake Gorgon doubles up as a threat, Anthousa is very clearly a threat. And the both Nylea's emissaries are. I mean, double Fairies Band Centaur is not the most exciting thing in the world, but it is worth looking at. Could easily play a 17 land, I think. I like 18 land in general, but with Nylea's Presence, Voyaging Satyr, Burnished Heart, and Opaline Unicorn, I think 17 is going to be better than 18 here. It's also worth mentioning Viper's Kiss because it's so good against Monstrous. And there's also Ill-Tempered Cyclux, which I'm pretty tempted to splash, maybe instead of Blood Toll Harpy. The only reason I really like Harpy in here is because I can put an Nylea's Emissary on it, but other than that, it doesn't do a whole lot for me. I also could cut Fairy's Band Centaur just because that card is not super impressive. I mean, it does pretty much exactly what it says it does, but that's not a whole lot. So I'm pretty sure I want to play the Ill-Tempered Cyclops just because it's another really good threat, and I don't think there's anything else that was really calling out to me. So let's table the cut, whether it's Blood Toll Harpy or Fairy's Band Centaur, and look at another deck real quick. Let's take out the black, just move it over there for ease of use, put in my one drop, and let's go ahead and take a look at what the red version of the deck would look like. So I'd have those at 3. I probably actually wouldn't play Open Unicorn or Burnished Heart, and it's not like I love either of those cards, but I think they're fine in a high curve green-black deck. They combo with Night Howler too, the Burnished Heart especially. Alright, so clearly still playing those. Might actually not play Nylea's Presence here, just because if this is Anomaly and aggro deck, then I might want to keep the curve down and not have low curve things that don't advance the board. So this one, we're probably trying to play like Portent of Betrayal stuff. Let's cut the Artisan Sorrow for the moment. I don't really want to play Spark Jolt. I like Borderland Minotaur well enough. Rageblade Shaman seems pretty necessary. Could splash Kragma Warcaller, but that again seems a little unnecessary, especially with no fixing this time. So what does this look like? Well, Karameet's Acolyte and Nylea's Disciple are not very good in here. Neither are the Fairy's Band Centaurs. Yeah, I don't like this as much. It's got less removal spells, and you're still really not going to curve out all that often. Yeah, sometimes you're going to play Arena Athlete into Rageblood Shaman into, like, I guess Borderland Minotaur and Portent of Betrayal, but I don't think that's nearly as likely as just want to try to stabilize the game, draw cards with Breathe the Bones, and cast Sip and Keepsake Gorgon. So let's do Pause by Color again, take out the Lightning Strike. Yeah, I used to play at Adventures On in Sacramento. Take out the Lightning Strike, and where'd it go? Rage of Purphoros, since I think those are the ones I wanted, plus the Ill-Tempered Cyclops. I like that one too. Pull those out, put in those, put in Nylea's Presence, and put in all these. And the Artisan Sorrow being the last card, and then cutting. I'm just going to cut the Fairy's Band Center, and I'll keep the one flyer just in case. Alright, I'm not going to play Unknown Shores. I think the card's pretty bad. Let's go ahead and suggest 8-3-5. Well, I'm not playing 3 Mountains. I'm likely playing 1, because that leaves 2, 3, 4, 5 red sources, which I think is fairly solid. And this leaves 7 Swamps, which I think is good, especially since we do want to cast Ferrica's Cure reasonably early. And it's really 10 black sources and 10 green sources, 11 green sources even, so I actually think the mana in this deck is very good. So, this is the deck I would start with. I would certainly consider sideboarding Fade into Antiquity, Shredding Winds, even Destructive Revelry if you face someone with a ton of enchantments artifacts. Though I would side in Fade before Revelry just because the mana cost is so much easier. And besides siding those in, I'd also look at potentially, you know, siding in Viper's Kiss and even something like Fellhide Minotaur or the Return Phalanx, just because if you're playing against a fast deck, you'd rather just have the low drops. You could look at playing other colors. I don't really think there's any way to get blue in there besides splashing a Shipbreaker Kraken. I could see, under some circumstances, splashing a red or turning into the red-green deck. And the red-black deck's got to be way too short on cards. Yeah, I don't think it's too close. I don't think this deck can get away with not playing green. All right, I'm going to submit because this is what I want to play. But let's go ahead and maybe take a quick glance at the black. You get to play 2 Flesh Mad Steeds, 2 Marauders. I don't really like the way this is going to look, but let's just see, just out of curiosity. And I guess the Fellhide Minotaur goes in. This is 21. So it's got 3 2-drops. Yeah, it has even less 2-drops, and it's even playing stuff like Read the Bones, which is, I mean, you'd play it, but it's not a super exciting card in this deck. You do get to have better removal than the green-black deck, or a green-red deck, for obvious reasons. And there's not a whole lot you can do in terms of making the curve lower. I mean, yeah, you've got a Crow and Crusader, but without Dragon Mantles, I really don't think that the card's going to get there. Couldn't play Unicorn or Burnished Heart, or even Viper's Kiss, but I don't love that. Although Kragma Warcaller actually would be good in the deck. Actually, this deck seems like it could be, let's just play, say, the Viper's Kiss as the last cards. This deck seems like it could have a little bit of punch, and I suppose if you feel like your deck is really, really outclassed, if I played against someone with a ton of bombs, then I think this is something I might side into, especially since the Night Howlers and the Spearpoint Oreads mean that the curve of the deck isn't so, you know, so low curve and nothing high. You do have, let's say, a 6-drop here to play as well. And there's a bunch of removal. I mean, it's got 1, 2, 3, 4 goodish removal spells, then a Viper's Kiss and a Portent of Betrayal is kind of loose removal spells. It's got Hammer, which is decent, though you do have a lot of haste guys already. And it's got some finishers in Mogus's Marauder, which is nice, but I still think this deck might have a little trouble closing out the game, just because you're missing out on the 2 Nylea's Emissaries and the Anthousa as really solid threats, and the green deck gives you Leafcrown Dryad and Voyaging Satyr as 2-drops, which are both very, very important. So I'm going to start with the green deck, but I actually could see siding into this deck as well.